For those of us that aren't with us in person but might be listening online or in some other way. And we pray that even though we're hearing things and interacting differently, that we are together, that we all are the body of Christ, and there's great unity in that. And Father, we think about leaders who are having to manage COVID across the country, and we just pray for wisdom and guidance and sense in how they roll out regulations around COVID, and pray that that we as a country would respect all that as well. We think of those in our church family at the moment who are going through different things, and we think particularly of Ken and Julie as they live through that stressful period of Julie's mum fading in Ben Home, and we just pray that you will be with them and give them a sense of your peace and upholding through that time. So Father, we thank you again for being here with us, that we can worship you, that we can encourage one another together. And we just ask your blessing on our time. In Jesus' name, amen. So just a few housekeeping things. I don't want this to be the focus of the morning. So I've got a slide, I'll pop it. So just remembering that there's really just three things you've got to keep in mind when it comes to meeting together. That A, if you're not feeling well, don't come. And we will miss you, but if you're not feeling well, don't come. Go and see your doctor, get sorted out, just to make sure you're not going to be spreading something that nobody wants. The other thing is social distancing, so we're doing our best with chairs. And it's going to be tempting for you to want to hug one another, but we're just encouraging you to, I guess, be just conscious of that social distancing thing that we need to put in place. And the other thing is, we've just got to be diligent with our hygiene. So we've got a number of hand wash stations. There's one in the foyer, there's one on the back table. So just make sure you're using that throughout the morning. So that's, I guess, the first thing. The second thing is that at the end of the service, we've actually got to wipe this place down. So if we could have three or four people who might be able to just give their time, it will only take us probably 10 or 15 minutes if we get three or four. We're going to have to wipe the chairs, wipe the door handles, wipe those obvious surfaces that people have been using. So it would be helpful if we could have some volunteers at the end. Morning tea will look a little bit different. We are going to be serving you this morning. So our morning tea is a very dumbed down version of morning tea. It's just a simple tea and coffee and a pre-wrapped biscuit. So we'll be serving you just to make sure we can do that in the best way that we can. What are we looking at? Offering this morning as well. Instead of passing the basket around, we've got the offering basket sitting up on the back table near the doors. So as you're leaving, it would be very much appreciated that if you've come prepared to give, that you place that in the basket at the back. Communion as well. We won't be doing communion this morning because we are waiting on some pre-packaged communion things to come. So when they do arrive, we will be having communion together, but until then, we thought it was probably best that we don't. And finally, the kids have got activity packs. If you don't have them, we've got some activity packs for the kids with just some colouring in, because we're conscious that they are with us through the service this morning. Well, great. So Cam, thank you. Cam's just going to lead us in a time of worship.
I've got my microphone. This is my special microphone, so I'm not sharing one with Punchy. It has nothing to do with COVID, I just requested that. You will notice that you probably got pen and paper underneath your chair or around your chair. Like we said, we've got to wipe things down, so it helps out. Don't use the pen as a nose picker or something like that. That wouldn't be helpful. We're in a different season, obviously. I remember a conversation I had with my boss a few years ago where I was explaining to her as an early career teacher that I was struggling to find balance. That might not come as a surprise to some of you. And she actually shared with me, it was kind of brought me up a little bit, that the idea of having that sort of balance that I was requesting actually wasn't really a biblical model. And she said the Bible actually talks about seasons. And whilst I was right to try and get, bring back some of the work that I was doing, I actually pointed out that life goes in seasons. And there might be times when you have a lot of work you need to do, but there'll be times when you don't have as much. And I'm reflecting on that when I think about right now. We've been forced into a season that looks very different. And a big thing that's going to look different in our services is that we are not supposed to sing. It's a big part of... they have suggested that that's a big spreader in communities like ours would be for us all to jump in together in a confined space and start singing our lungs out. So for those of us who lead worship, we've been, I suppose, having a bit of a reflection on what does that mean for us. And I instantly started thinking about a story that may be well known to you. We've probably shared it before, but I'll just quickly share some of it again. The singer-songwriter and worship leader, Matt Redman, he was told by his pastor, I think maybe his priest, I think he was at an Anglican church at the time. The minister came to the congregation and said that, I think we need to move into a new season, and I think we're going to move away from using music for worship. And they had Matt Redman as a worship pastor there, or a worship leader there. I'm sure they were big on music. And so for us, I'm sure they were thinking, oh, what are we going to do? And for him, he thought, what am I going to do? This is my role. And he thought that we're going to have to change things up a bit. We're going to have to look at how we do worship differently. Because the minister said, we have all these lights and productions and things like that. I think we need to strip all of that away because we have a big emphasis on music here at this church. And we need to see if we've still got an offering to bring. And I think for us, we've been forced into a season that looks a little bit different. And no, we're not supposed to come together and sing. And we didn't want to just jump up and sing for you this morning and say, don't sing, but I will. I thought that might be a bit tempting for us all. I'm sure we'd all be singing under our breath. I thought, let's look at things differently. Let's think, what have I got as an offering to bring to my Lord this morning? So I don't know exactly what it's going to look like for you right now, but I wanted to offer us some space. It might be some space to be still and know that He is Lord. It might be some time to be creative. You'll notice you've got the pens and paper. You might want to write out some scripture. You might want to write out some sort of haiku. You might want to write out some sort of poetry. You might want to write some sort of creative reflection on what it is that you think this season has taught you about your relationship with God. For me, I know that sometimes when I come, I'll be honest, and I stand there and I sing, sometimes I go through the motions. I get to stand there and flick to autopilot for a while and just kind of sing with everybody else. And it's not necessarily, I'm not necessarily actively engaging in the music, in the worship. And so that song of Heart of Worship, which, Chris, if you want to start playing that instrumental version for me, that song Heart of Worship talks about when the music fades and all is stripped away and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. And I think that's the season that we're in now, because the music has been forced to fade for us. We can't play our music up here, and we are great at it. But we do need to think about how we're going to do things differently. So later on, I'll come back and we'll have a bit more of a reflective time. Worship is going to look different in this season. It might not look exactly like this, but for this morning, what we're going to do is I'm going to give you some time to reflect and to maybe worship God in a different way. And you might not want to write, you don't have to. You might want to just sit in prayer. Maybe you've had a week. I know sometimes I have a week where I get to the end of it and I think, oh, I don't think I've spent any time just alone with God. So here's some time for you. So I'll hand this over to you now. I'll give you this time to think about it. And one last thought is, I remember hearing Matt Redman say the first week that they did it, it was a bit awkward. Which I thought, all right, I'll take that. It might be a bit awkward for us today, but maybe as we ease into it, it might become more normal. Right. I'll give you this time.
Angels and nesting for your glory, may you.
to say a prayer to lift this up. And looking around, I'm really touched to see people engaging in worship in a different way. I just want to say thank you to see you worshiping. It was really beautiful. I want to pray, I want to offer this up to God, and then I was wondering if you would join me in the Lord's Prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you that we are not limited to music. Music is a beautiful thing that we can worship through, and we thank you for that. But that we have a new season where we get to explore what worship means, communal worship means, when we don't have music. And we ask that your Holy Spirit would lead us in that, lead the people making decisions in that, that we would be so empowered by your Holy Spirit in a new way, that we would be drawn into relationship with you that goes deeper because of this season, not in spite of this season, but we can use this season and your Holy Spirit can do amazing, awesome things through what's happening by moving away from the distraction perhaps that the music may bring. But perhaps we might be able to move into a time where we just bring a new offering to you, Lord, that brings us deeper. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, hallowed be thy name.
Thank you, Cam. So we might just pop the headlines up. We'll go through those. It'd be great. So what's on? What's on at the moment? Not a lot of sort of participating things, but still things that you can get involved with in different ways. So this is church is starting back. It'll be the start of us meeting regularly, which is great. And from term three, we'll be looking at the book of Galatians and just looking at that beautiful theme of grace. So it would be great to have you along and enjoying that with us. Wildfire Youth is back, although they are now breaking. Are you breaking for school holidays, Jeremy?
Yeah, 2 weeks.
So breaking for school holidays for 2 weeks and then back term three. So if you've got kids, great spot for them to be on Friday nights. Our MBC Family Camp. Now, this was one that we were going to have earlier in the year, but we've had to look at a revised date. So we're now looking at the end of October. So the last weekend in October, first weekend in November. So would be great to have you there. Put it in your diaries, and we'll come back to you with more detail on that as we go over the next few months. And things have been happening in the life of church. We've had two new additions. So we've had one of the Rugrock clan has extended yet again. So Emily and Jacob have had little baby William, and we haven't seen him here yet, but I'm sure we will soon. And it's just great that he's arrived safely. And also the Winters had a little boy, Ezra Joseph. So it's a good season for boys, born on the 25th of June, and they're all doing really well. We look forward to seeing them with us as well. Next Saturday, which is I think the 11th, or this coming Saturday now, the 11th, we're going to have a men's trip up through the Barringtons. So if you've got a four-wheel drive, or even if you don't have a four-wheel drive but you would like to be involved and participate, give Neil Parrish a call, and Neil will arrange for you to be able to come. We would love to see you there. So as many guys as you can rally, let's try and make this a really great day. Leaving the church next Saturday, 8 o'clock.
And for the ladies, my homes are open up to 20 people.
So Nicole is volunteering. So for all of the women that are widowed for the day, because the guys are going four-wheel driving, then you can go to Nicole and Lindsay's in Rutherford. There's a great offer. And again, we'll be having morning tea at the end of the service, so great time for us all to catch up. So for the kids, we have a special little presentation here just for the kids. And if you like puppets, you'll probably like this. And even for the big kids, there'll be something in this that I'm sure you will enjoy. So let's watch this.
I'm Chrissy.
And I'm Clowstick.
And welcome back to QuizWorks Home Delivery. Today, as we look at Acts chapter 12, we are going to witness a battle.
Oh, a battle? Oh, I better go and get ready.
Wait, go and get ready for what? Anyway, as we look at this battle, we are going to see, why don't you do it with me, that the mission of the risen King Jesus cannot be stopped.
Okay, I'm back.
Krusik, what are you doing?
Ooh, I'm ready for the battle.
No, we're not fighting anyone.
We're not.
No, as we look at Acts chapter 12, we are going to see a battle between two kings.
Oh, okay.
The first king is King Herod. And King Herod really wanted to stop the mission of the risen King Jesus.
Ooh.
And the second king is the risen King Jesus himself.
Oh, excellent. Two kings who are battling out to the death.
Are you okay?
Oh, I think so.
Well, we are going to watch this story as a shadow puppet play. King Herod was a very powerful man, and King Herod wanted to stop people spreading the mission of the risen King Jesus. So King Herod had the Apostle James arrested. The Apostle James had been one of the main people who told others about Jesus.
Jesus is the risen King.
But when the Apostle James was brought before King Herod, Herod ordered that James be killed. Herod thought this might help stop the mission of Jesus spreading. But Herod hadn't finished yet. Herod decided to arrest the Apostle Peter as well. But rather than just kill Peter straight away, Herod thought it would be better if Peter was put on trial in front of everyone. Then everyone would be too scared to share the message of Jesus. So Herod threw Peter into jail while he organized the time for the trial. It seemed like King Herod was winning.
Yeah, maybe Herod was the most powerful king.
It looked that way.
Oh, if King Herod could get rid of all of Jesus' messages, then the mission of the risen King Jesus could be stopped.
Well, that's right. But Acts chapter 12, verse 5 says, the church never stopped praying for Peter.
But how's that going to help when Peter's locked up in jail?
Well, the night before Peter was to be put on trial, Peter was sleeping in King Herod's jail, bound between two guards. It seemed like he would be going nowhere. Suddenly, an angel from the risen King Jesus appeared. The angel woke up Peter, but left the guards asleep. The angel told Peter to follow him, and Peter did. But the prison doors were shut. Surely that would keep Peter locked in. But when Peter and the angel came to the doors opened all by themselves. And so Peter was set free.
Woohoo! He is free!
He is!
It's a draw!
It looked that way. King Herod had killed James, but King Jesus had set Peter free.
Oh, who is the most powerful king? Who will win in the end?
Well, let's see. Let's see if the mission of the risen King Jesus could be stopped. Sometime later, King Herod was again in a palace. crowd of people came to listen to him speak. King Herod spoke so well that all the people started worshipping him as a god.
You're a god, Herod!
Yes,
you're a god,
Herod! Immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, he was struck down by God. And a short time later, Herod died.
Whoa! It's not a draw any longer!
No, King Herod had died. But the Bible tells us that the mission of the risen King Jesus, it continued to grow and grow and grow.
Whoa, that was an incredible battle.
Yes, it really was.
And I'm all inspired now for my own battle.
Are you okay?
Oh, yeah, but I don't think battles are for me.
Probably not.
Yeah, I think I'm just gonna go and eat some yummy pencil pie. Oh, that's a pie packed full of yummy pencils.
Oh. All right, you go and do that. See you later, Kosei.
See ya!
Well, today we saw a battle between two kings. King Herod really wanted to stop the mission of the risen King Jesus. And today, many people continue to try and stop the mission of the risen King Jesus. But while King Herod could do terrible things to the messengers, he could not stop Jesus' mission. Because Jesus is the King, and Jesus is always in control. And so we can know that, do it with me, the mission of the risen King Jesus cannot be stopped. And so we need to keep trusting King Jesus and keep spreading his mission. And so to help you, don't forget to visit www.quizworks.com/home-delivery, where you'll find games, activities, devotional questions to help you as you continue to think about Jesus' unstoppable mission from the Book of Acts. See you next time.
So there's a tip, Mum and Dad. QuizWorks, that's a really good little website if you're looking to get your kids engaged with some of the gospel message that's done through Puppet. So Sheree and I, we're actually good friends with the guy that operates COSEC, so we should try and get them up here one weekend. That'd be heaps of fun for the kids. Okay, Jeremy. Time to hear from Jeremy this morning as he brings a message to us. I might pray for you, Jeremy.
Good morning, how are we all today? I'm feeling pretty good. I'm really excited to be back here at church with you guys face to face. Stick up your hand if you're excited to be back at church face to face. Most people around the room, that is awesome. I don't know about you, but I've really missed seeing so many beautiful faces here, spending time with our church family, and it is so good to be back. So I have the privilege of sharing with you guys this morning, but before I do that, can we please pray together? So let's just close our eyes, bow our heads. Dear God, we thank you that you are so holy. We thank you that you are so loving, and that we can be here today as a church family, church community, and we're able to actually spend time together face to face. And we pray, God, that you just help us today to help our hearts be open, to just receive your love and the truth that you got, that you have for us. And we thank you, God, that even through this season, you've been working in people's hearts. And we pray, Lord, that you just help us today to just be closer to you and closer to your heart. Amen. Awesome, guys. So, like I said, I get the privilege of speaking this morning. And the topic that I get to speak about this morning is three lessons that COVID-19 taught us. So the purpose behind the sermon which I'm going to give to you guys this morning is actually due to reflection. It's because we've just been through a crazy season, right? We've been through a few months which have looked maybe a little bit different to what we normally have been experiencing, that maybe is a little bit more challenging for us than other seasons of life. And I believe it would be a big mistake to actually come out of this season of the last few months back into normal life without actually reflecting on how we can better our lives in areas of our relationship with God or just our lives in general. It's a really great time now to think about how we can actually use the experiences that we've had the last few months and use those for the good. in our lives. So I'm just going to launch straight into it. The first lesson which we're going to talk about is focus on community. Who here has missed the church community and the community of others around? Just about everybody, right? So I've asked a lot of people this question. What have you missed most about, you know, not meeting face-to-face within church? And by far, the most common answer has been, I've missed the people, I've missed the community. And this is a very biblical thing as well. In Genesis 2:18, it says, it is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper. We all know that, you know, it is good to have others around us. 1 Thessalonians 5:11, Paul wrote, encourage one another and build one another up. Again, we all know that it's important to actually be encouraging other people up, and it is also important to have people around us, you know, encouraging us as well. I'm going to just list a few things that church community brings, because while talking about this, I'm going to talk about what is community within the church and outside of the church, but more than that, why we should be intentional about community and what that actually brings for us. So church community brings encouragement. I mentioned that a little bit. People need to be encouraged. We all need to be encouraged to actually, you know, follow God's plan and purpose in our lives, encouraged to read the Bible, pray, things like that. Church community brings support. And we've got a photo here. Don't worry, this photo was taken before social distancing, so don't you worry about that. It's an analogy here. I don't know if you've ever done an exercise like this where people have their arms around each other in a row. Point that I want to make with this is that if one person, you know, tried to fall forward or backwards, tried to fall out of that line, then they wouldn't actually be able to, because they've got people around them holding them. And that's an analogy which I feel like can actually represent how we need to support each other within the church. You know, we all go through rough times, we all go through rough patches, but a real community, a real loving community should be a place where when people fall down, we can offer a hand to help them back up. When people go through tough times, the church can be people who actually stand up and say, hey, we're in this together, you are not alone in this season. Wisdom. I'm so thankful for so many people in this church who are full of wisdom that have been able to help me, you know, navigate certain life decisions or certain life circumstances. So it's important to have community with people of wisdom, and more importantly, biblical wisdom as well. Prayer. Now, in talking about what church community brings, these are things that the church community can bring within the church, but it's also things that the church community can bring to people that are unchurched or maybe outside of the church. Now, prayer, I feel like, is one of the most powerful things that we can actually do as a church community. Praying for one another, praying for, you know, people outside the church, praying together, because when God is in the midst of what we're doing and is working in people's lives, that's when things really get good. Church community brings serving. So within the church, we're able to serve one another. We're able to serve people outside the church, and we can do that together. And that's actually a huge part of God's calling for our lives. And also friendship. So church community should be something that we should enjoy and find a lot of joy in because of the friendship that we can have. So I've now covered what church community should be. Now I'm going to get a little bit deeper into the specifics. I love this quote. It's by one of my favorite authors and pastors, Andy Stanley. The idea is that the people you spend time with will determine your direction and destination. So when it talks about your direction and destination, we're referencing this in terms of your whole life, in terms of where you're heading in life. Just think about the people that you spend your most time with, the people that just the few people that you spend the most time with, and you add their characters, their, you know, visions, their the things that they want to achieve in life, you add them all together, and that can be, you know, approximately or an estimation of where you will actually end up, or the characteristics which you'll actually communicate in your life. So the idea is that, you know, the people that you spend time with in your life actually have a huge influence on where you end up. And we need to spend time with you know, a lot of different type of people. You know, Jesus didn't only spend time with his disciples, but also a lot of the marginalized in society. But it is important to spend time with people that help build us up and help us to, you know, be encouraged in areas of life that we want to be encouraged in. The Bible says it in a different way. Proverbs 13, verse 20 says, "Walk with the wise and become wise, for a companion of fools suffers harm." So Solomon was writing here that, you know, if you want to become wise, well, then spend time with people who are wise. If you want to become more of a godly person and a God-centered person, then spend time with people who are also godly and more God-centered. So this is just a really big encouragement for some of us to, you know, to just be really intentional about who we spend our time with, because it actually does make a big impact in our lives. This is the final statement which I want to talk about on the area of church community, but I feel like it's incredibly important. God's church is the hope of the world. It's a bit of a cliche statement, but I just want us to look at now at a passage which is in John 17. This is a prayer that Jesus had not long before he was actually taken hostage and crucified on the cross. This is a prayer for the church, and I believe this is a prayer that Jesus actually prayed for even our church right now. Jesus praying. He says, "I pray for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one." So when it says all of them may be one, it means being united, that the church is united in heart, in mission. "Father, just as you are in me and I am in you." So just as close as Jesus is to God, that's a picture of how close we should be united as a church, which is crazy to think about, right? You know, Jesus and God are literally one. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. Going to continue on. Same passage. It says, "I have given them glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I and them and you and me, so that they may be brought to complete unity." Complete unity. "Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." So I don't know if you've got the picture, but Jesus is saying here, hey, if the church is one, if the church is unified, if the church is loving one another the way that the Father loves the Son, then that is how people will believe. It says here, "Then the world will know you have sent me and have loved them, even as you have loved me." So Jesus didn't say here, hey, if cool miracles happen, that is how people will understand the truth and the love of God. Jesus doesn't say, hey, well, if we get the most incredible speaker and the best musician in the world and they play music at the exact right volume, that is how people will be able to know the love of God and accept Jesus. Jesus doesn't say that. He actually says when the church is unified, when the church is actually loving one another the way that that God intends them to, then that is when people will be able to accept Jesus. That is when people will go, wow, there's something different about these type of people. When the church is united in vision and in mission, that is when the church can truly be the hope in the world, which Jesus actually empowers us to be. We're going to now move on to the second lesson, which is focus on God, spending time with Him. So I'm not going to get you guys to raise your hand, but I'm feeling like some people in this room have struggled a little bit actually staying in touch with God or spending time with God throughout social isolation. Maybe some of that is because, you know, you haven't had people around you, a church or, you know, face-to-face in connect groups, things like that to actually help encourage you. But I do know for a fact as well that some people have actually grown even more in their relationship with God because maybe you guys had a little bit more time on your hands to actually, you know, read the Bible and pray and spend time with Him. And if so, then that's awesome. For me, it was a little bit of both. You know, I started off social isolation a little bit rough, where I felt a little bit unmotivated to actually spend time with God because I didn't have people around me to encourage me as much. But partway through isolation, I really spent time reflecting on myself and going, no, this is my choice, actually spent time with God. And I became a lot more intentional to say, hey, it's my choice to spend time with Him. So my point here is building a relationship with God is a personal choice. And I don't know if you guys know this, but you can turn up to church every week, you can know the Bible back to front, like the Pharisees did, but maybe you still don't actually have a growing relationship with God. Or maybe you don't even have a relationship with God at all. You could look like the best Christian on the outside, but God actually looks in the inside. What's happening in the inside and in your quiet time with God? Because that's the thing that truly speaks volumes about your faith, and that's what God looks at. He looks at your heart. You've been given 1,440 minutes per day. Just in case you guys don't know, that's a lot of minutes, right, that God gives us per day. Every single breath that we take, God has given us. And an encouragement for you guys this morning is that maybe God is asking you to actually spend maybe 20 minutes, maybe half an hour, out of that 1,440 minutes to actually spend time with Him. Now, it doesn't really sound like much compared to that, right? Another way to say this is, imagine right now if I said to you, for every single day for the rest of your life, I'm going to give you $1,440. I'm going to do that. There is one catch though. Every single time I give you that money, you have to give me $20 back. Do you think you'd take that offer? I think you'd do that. I think you'd be silly if you didn't take that offer. That's a lot of money in your pocket, right? Tax-free. It's good. The analogy that I'm trying to make is that God has given you, you know, all this time, all these minutes. Now, how are you using your time? If God is encouraging you now to actually give 20 minutes back a day, 30 minutes back a day, are you willing to actually do that and say, God, you've given me everything that I have. You've given me every breath which I'm going to take. Are you going to spend time each day thanking Him for what He's been doing in your life? You're going to spend some time each day praising Him, glorifying Him? Because for a lot of us, you know, that's what He's challenging you to do. He's actually expecting and hoping that you'll spend more time developing your relationship with Him. Some of you guys say, you know, I'm too busy. And in this day and age, people are very busy with so many commitments and family life, a lot of things going on. But the truth is that we make time for the things that are most important to us. You know, if you have time to watch TV or spend time on your phone, or if you have time to even eat, then you have time to actually spend time with God. You have time to read the Bible. The Bible actually talks about how it's more important to have spiritual food than it is to have, you know, physical food. And so I'm encouraged by that. Just say it's more important to actually spend time with God reading the Bible than it is to even just eat breakfast in the morning. I'm going to go through now different ways we can spend time with God. Now, some of these are pretty obvious, but some of these as well are things which I hope you feel encouraged to try in your relationship with God and try at home. Because some of us are really good at some of these things, but some of these things maybe you haven't tried or haven't tried in a long time. And I feel like, sort of like our relationship with people, you know, sometimes it's not just the exact same conversation that you have every day or the exact same approach. Sometimes we've actually got to make sure that we are connecting with God in different ways, and that is when our faith will feel more alive. So the first way we can spend time with God is pray and listen. Now, I feel like in my life I'm a little bit I'm better at praying than listening. Is anybody on the same boat with that? So I sometimes struggle a little bit to be still and actually ask, hey God, you know, what do you want to speak to me about today? What do you want to tell me in my life, in my current situation? Another one is read the Bible. So this year I'm taking up the challenge of reading the Bible from cover to cover. I haven't done that before. I'm currently in 1 Chronicles, and I've read a lot of the Bible which I haven't read before. But, you know, throughout this season, I've been learning so much just about, you know, my faith and about God's Word. And it's really been challenging me and encouraging me in so many different ways. And a challenge for you guys as well is whenever you read the Bible, I encourage you to actually pray and ask God to reveal His truth to you and reveal what He wants to speak to you, because I feel like that's been one of the main things that has helped me get a lot out of the Bible. So pray to Him before you actually open it and say, God, help me to actually understand what You want to tell me. Help me to actually have a passion for this word, because it is, you know, we believe here at Maitland Baptist Church that the Bible is God-breathed, God-inspired, and that every single word in there is there for a purpose. And God can work through the Bible and through the Scriptures in incredible ways. So when we spend time with God and praying, and we're praying to Him as we read the Bible, then that's just an incredible way that we can hear from God. Because a lot of people have a lot of questions, right? There's big questions in this world that all of us have and all of us must struggle with. But God has given us so many answers so clearly through His Word. So I encourage you guys to spend some time in the Bible this week, as well as just praying, God, help reveal Your truth to me in this. Another one is music. A lot of us feel like we can connect to God through music. And I don't just say that because I'm a worship leader and because I'm a music teacher, but I'd love to just hear from God through music. I feel like worship and praise music is very powerful. Another one is nature. Who here feels closer to God when they're in nature? Yeah, a few people, that's awesome. I feel super connected to God sometimes when I'm standing, you know, at the top of a cliff or at the beach or walking through a forest, and I go, wow, God, creation is awesome. You are so good. So maybe that's one way that you can connect to God this week. Another one is people. Some of us feel more energized and connected to God when we're surrounded by godly people in our lives. And another one is serving. There is more than this, but I feel like serving is a thing that we often underestimate. There's a way that can help us connect with God and His vision for our lives. And oftentimes in my experience, when I'm serving, I have to rely on God's strength, wisdom, and guidance in different areas. And it can really actually help us fuel our faith and practice our faith as well. So this is just a list of ways. Again, there's more than this. But if in your life and your relationship with God at the moment, if you aren't experimenting or trying with all of these different methods, then yeah, I encourage you to do so this week. 2 Peter 3 verse 18 says, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So I feel like Peter sums it up really well here, saying that in the lives of Christians, in our lives, our role and responsibility is to be constantly growing in grace and knowledge, growing in the concept, understanding what Jesus' grace really looks like in our life, but also the knowledge of, hey, okay, now I'm saved. Now I believe that, you know, Jesus died on the cross, that the freedom that I have in Jesus means that I can live without sin. And, you know, that's the most incredible thing we can experience. You can understand that, but then the knowledge of, you know, what grace actually means in your life. How can we now live knowing that there's a grace that we can have in Jesus? Number three, the last lesson from COVID is focus on eternity. Live with the big questions in mind. And this is a lesson here because the thought process behind this one is because, you know, unfortunately a lot of people in the season have actually passed away. Unfortunately, a lot of people have struggled all around the world in sickness and in trauma, and have really been confronted with the big questions. People ask, what is the purpose of my life? You know, if I died this week, if I died today, you know, would my life have meaning? Would it have purpose? Or would it amount to nothing? And as Christians, you know, thankfully, we actually know that there is something greater than just this life here on earth. We can have hope and trust that Jesus has made a way for us to actually spend eternity with God when we believe in Him. But we should constantly be living every day with the perspective of eternity. So a question that I want to want you guys to think about while I'm speaking over the next few slides is, am I living my life in perspective of eternity or with just the fleeting things of now? Matthew 6 says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So a lot of us know this passage, but I feel like we should just constantly be focusing on this concept of, hey, every single thing that I'm doing today, is it for, you know, just right here, right now, or is it for something that will last way beyond that? Romans 12 verse 2 says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And I love the word transform there, because it really helps us to understand that, you know, if we actually want our priorities to be more about God and what He wants for His plan for our lives, then it's not like all of a sudden my life's going to go from my will to His. Transformed actually means it's a bit of a process. Sometimes in our life, we actually need to know that it's a process, that as we grow in our relationship with God, God will reveal to us the ways in which we can actually surrender things to Him. And, you know, day by day we get closer to Him and closer to His plan and purpose. And we're able to become less like the world and more like God actually wants us to be. Because the truth is that the world looks very different today than what God actually, you know, intends for it, or God intends us to live. We, you know, as Christians, should be prioritizing different things than what unchurched people prioritize. So again, here's this question, which I want everybody to reflect on now in their own life, their own relationship with God. The question is, does your lifestyle show that you're living each day for eternity or for now? And I deliberately didn't put, does your lifestyle, or do you say that you're living each day for eternity or now? Because it's pretty easy as Christians to say, of course, yeah, I'm living for eternity and not for the now, but then, you know, go home or go back to our families and just be selfish in different ways and live mostly for ourselves. And in this culture, a lot of us are very, very blessed. You know, we have a lot of possessions, we have a lot of time, and culture is actually all about, you know, what do I want right now in this day and age? And for us, a huge challenge is to actually have a different perspective than modern culture and say, you know what, everything that I'm doing now, the rewards aren't something that I'm going to get right here, right now on this earth. A lot of the rewards of what I'm doing should actually be for treasures in heaven, you know, eventually after this worldly life of mine is done and gone. So again, does your lifestyle show that you're living each day for eternity or for now? If an outsider came and inspected your life, would they see that you're living for eternity or not? For me, this was just a huge challenge. This is the last verse which I wanted to cover. 1 John 3 verse 16 says, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down His life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. So I know that we've covered a fair few points, and I hope that some of these points have encouraged you to grow in your faith, or to spend more time with God. But I really just want to finish encouraging you guys to think about your own life. Are you living your life for yourself, for your own benefits? Or are you living your life with such a greater purpose, for something that's so much bigger than just yourself? And I feel like this is a question we should continuously be asking ourselves each day for the rest of our lives. And for me personally, I've been waking up in the morning and deliberately have been intentional about saying, God, today this life isn't mine. Today this life is yours. Today, God, I want to surrender to you, because I can't make an eternal impact for God's kingdom or for anything living this life by myself without God. So God, I want to give my life to you. So I'm just going to finish up by praying and actually asking God, we're going to ask God together to help us grow in Him and take our next step, no matter what that looks like, that next step towards knowing Him better. So let's close our eyes, bow our heads, and we're going to pray. Dear God, we thank you that you've given us every single moment, that you've given us every single breath that we have. Lord, we pray right now that you help us to see things in an eternal perspective. Help us to see our lives in such a way that you do. We pray, God, that you help us to live lives with purpose, with a meaning that's beyond us, but is focused on you. We pray, God, that you help us to understand the true sacrifice that your Son Jesus made on the cross. And help us to be just thankful and live our lives to just glorify you because of what you've done for us. Help us to grow in your grace and your truth as well, God. I pray that you help us all to just take the next step that we have just to get closer to you, God, and to understand more of your incredible plan and purpose for not only our lives, but for eternity as well. Help us to fall deeper in love with you this week, Jesus. In your name, amen. Thanks, guys. We'll pass this off to Cam.